Opinions expressed on the Jay Thomas Show are the opinions of the host, participating callers, listener emails, and or letters, and are not necessarily the opinions of WDAY or Forum Communications. WDAY 970 AM and 93.1 FM invite you to make your opinion known. We pride ourselves on exploring all viewpoints on any topic.
Do you know who I am? I don't know how to put this, but kind of a big deal. People know me.
I'm very happy for you.
The Jay Thomas Show. Good afternoon. Welcome to the program. Hope everybody had a good weekend. Yeah, let's get her done. Let's get her done. Nice, Ronnie. All right, I'm getting a lot of emails. People concerned. I know, Ronnie, you sent me something from Representative Kelly Armstrong.
Yep.
That he's posted up, and there's a story out. We're trying to get to all this tomorrow, not today. The Washington Post has a story up that the Biden administration is considering flying these migrants to states near the Canadian border for processing. And Congressman Kelly Armstrong, he's not happy about this. He and others are not. Don't send this up here.
And if you're concerned about Corona, you sure as heck should be concerned about it, too.
So I've got a request to Congressman Armstrong. And I believe at 3:05 tomorrow, Lieutenant Governor Brent Sanford will join us on the program. With that said, Rob Port, standingblog.com. It's Monday. We always hook up with. I got an update from our flag guy here at 2:35. Andrew Ulmer, the guy that was told to take his flag down by the Homeowners Association here in Fargo because, it makes too much noise in the wind. We got an update from him coming up this afternoon. Finally, heard back from Senator Larry Lewick. He's going to join us at 3:35 to explain why he wants North Dakota to be the guinea pig for these road trains. So he joins us. And then Charlie Johnson, the president of the FM Convention and Visitors Bureau, is going to be at studio 3:05. We really haven't touched a whole lot on this, Rob, on this program. I know you've written about it. And that is this transgender bill that is going through here, I believe, on the Senate now, and it's still got to go on a judiciary hearing. Senate then will make their decision on it. I see that. Now, I don't know. I think now I heard a different story, but I know in South Dakota that Governor Kristi Noem, I heard it this morning on the national news, originally for it in South Dakota, but then said when it gets to her desk now, she's going to veto it. Because her people are telling her, if you pass this thing, this means a lot of money not coming to the state of South Dakota.
And she wants some changes to it, is my understanding of it. She's sending it back to the legislature. She wants it rewritten in some different ways. I don't know what her specific objections are. There's a lot of pressure people bring in. My column about this is that everybody just needs to unclench about this issue a little bit. I can understand why transgendered people are anxious to. It's a relatively new thing that they're emerging into the daylight in our communities, in our society, more in recent years than they have in the past. They've always been with us, obviously, but obviously things are moving right now. Mm-hmm. And generally, I think that's a good thing. The thing is that our society, in a lot of meaningful ways, is organized around the concept of two genders, right? Yep. Whether it's bathrooms, whether it's sporting leagues, we do a lot of it. Yeah. And so as our transgendered friends and neighbors, come into the daylight there are some changes that we need to make. The problem is that it's the situation that we're in is it sometimes feels like you either support the exact changes that the activists want or you're a bigot.
Exactly.
And those are our only choices. I mean, Harry Potter books are getting torched. Anybody who expresses a dissenting point of view on this is just getting lit up. And that's not a healthy environment. Listen, there's some things that we probably need to change in order to accommodate this, right? I mean, that's that's the whole point of public policy is no man is an island. We're all living in a society with one another. Our lives intersect, and at those intersections, we need public policy. So when it comes to sports, I don't think it's an invalid concern to say, you know, what do we do if somebody just decides to identify, you know, a male athlete decides to identify as a woman and then just starts schooling everybody? Because that's why we segregate sports by sex to begin with. No. If the women had to compete with the men, not very many women would get to play sports. Just a biological, not all of them. There's plenty of women out there who could mop the floor with me.
Oh, yeah.
I'll tell you that.
You and me both.
But, I mean, just in the aggregate, you know, male athletes are gonna probably just perform better overall than female athletes are. That's why we segregate the sports. But if we're going to have a new situation where maybe somebody who was born, and it's really hard to because so many of these terms are loaded. I'm not even sure what words I'm supposed to use and what I'm not used to.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to offend anybody here.
We're just being honest.
You know, I'm just trying to be, but somebody who was male at birth, who later identifies as a female and then starts just rocking everybody's world in track or something. I mean, is that fair?
Man, I've got two stories right here that I found, a week or two ago. That situation has happened. A gal out in Connecticut who was just doing fantastic. I believe we're up for scholarships, the whole kit and caboodle. I believe it was in track and field. And some guy identifies as a gal. He gets on the team and is just destroying records that have been in place for years. I mean, just it's really screwing with the female. I believe it's track and field. And then you have the same situation. Is it out in Utah? I believe it's Utah where the gals on the girls on the college teams are having an issue out there too. Just come on, man.
And I'm sure Rob has an opinion on this too, but. You know, there's other states that have passed this legislation in Connecticut, et cetera, and they had girls who I would imagine support overwhelmingly the Title IX provision. Mm-hmm. They came out and were in strong support of this bill that we want to be able to compete against other females.
Yeah.
And why are we all of a sudden, if other states have passed this legislation, why are we the bigots in the Midwest?
I think a lot of that's just timing. I will tell you one thing that I'm very tired of this argument.
Hold on. I'll tell you why, because it's North Dakota, and it seems like there's this mentality, well, it's little old flyover country, North Dakota, they're easy to pick on, and that's not the case.
Isn't that such a funny thing? I especially see it from our Democratic friends or left-leaning friends in the state where, like, North Dakota does something they don't like. So they all go fainting into the bushes like, oh, North Dakota's done something to embarrass us again. We're all so embarrassed. We're such a regressive state. Oh, this is just terrible. Like, you know, engage a little bit, right? Just because our legislature or our voters do something you don't like doesn't make us necessarily embarrassing. I mean, listen, sometimes the legislature and the voters do things I don't like, too. But, I mean, this whole idea like, oh, I'm so embarrassed of North Dakota. And I'm also tired of this argument, and I know your guest later in the show is going to make this argument, but this idea, well, the NCAA might not hold tournaments here anymore. Yeah. You know, Hollywood might not want to film their movies here anymore or whatever. That was a big one when Georgia had, I think, the bathroom bill or something like that.
Yeah.
Who voted for the NCAA, right? Who elected Hollywood celebrities to decide what North Dakota's going to do for its laws? But that's sort of the modern thing, right? Where if you say something somebody doesn't like, then they're going to come after, they're going to try to hurt you economically.
I can't believe the power this NCAA has, Rob. I shake my head at
off
that.
Off of players that by definition can't be paid.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
There's been some changes. Those players ought to be paid.
The idea that they're getting
everything that they need for what they put in, you know, performing in some of these sports, that they're getting everything they need from attendance at these schools is flipping ridiculous. And there's whole industry built around it. Yeah. The news media, there's reporters that are employed by it. University officials are getting rich. Big corporate America's getting rich. The NCAA's getting rich. And you know who ain't getting rich? Most of those players.
No, they're not. Jay and Moorhead, you're up, Jay Thomas Show.
Yeah, it's Jerry.
Hey, buddy.
A lot of us on here that listen to you, Jay, are probably of the older 50 and over crowd that remember back in the 70s when Mulder Walshaw their women's Olympic team just destroyed the Americans' women's Olympic team because of the drugs and steroids that they were pumping into their female athletes. Well, now that transgenders have those hormones naturally, doesn't it still fall under the category as like, well, this isn't fair?
Yeah, well, yeah. You know, you can do the argument because I'm the first one to say, hey, look, you know, you don't like it. Life's not fair. It's not. But this is a case where we have Title IX in this country, and this was so women could compete. And I don't care if you're taking hormones or whatever. You still were born a male. You've got that power. You have that power, even taking the hormones, that you're going to be able to overpower these women. Again, this is nothing against women. Like you said earlier, Rob, same thing for me. There are women out there just can completely dominate and smoke. I think there's women out there that could just kick ass in the NFL. But that's few and far between. And you're dropping these men that are identifying as women out of these teams, and they're screwing these girls are getting screwed over, and it's not right.
Do you remember back in the 70s there was a woman tennis player that got banned from women's sports because they found out she had been born a man and had a sex change?
Was that
the life of me can't remember her name, but I know it was.
I don't think
that
was
actually. You know, if you're interested in trans, HBO has a great documentary. I watch it because an editor that I used to work with Mark Lisheron is actually in it. It's called Lady in the Dale. And Jay, I think you'd like this because you're a car guy.
Yeah.
But it was about this woman, and she had been born a man, but was trying to sell a three-wheeled car called the Dale.
Okay.
And it was in the 70s, and it was supposed to revolutionize the auto industry, and it had super low gas mileage and all this stuff. And it's a whole story. The person at the center of it was transgender, but they mentioned this tennis player that the caller's talking about in the documentary. But if you're interested in trans issues, that's a really good documentary.
I've seen the documentary, Rob. It's absolutely fantastic. I mean,
you're going to buy HBO, right?
You're going to have to check it out, Jay. It's the twists and turns from this guy's life about how he started to where he eventually became the woman who tried to start the three-wheeled car. You'd never believe happened.
It's a fascinating story. Right. I mean, just the guy himself, or the gal, is just a fascinating, fascinating. Check Lady in the Dale, great show.
Hey, Jay, appreciate the phone call, brother. Let me take a break here. We'll come back. Our weekly chat with Rob Port, 293-9000, toll-free, 1-888-970-9329. I'm trying to talk at you bubblegum at the same time. I'll actually try to talk and read emails. Emails are saying, wasn't the tennis player Renee Richards? I don't know. I don't know. Rob, fan mail coming in, buddy. Fan mail alert.
Uh-oh.
Fan mail alert. Hold on.
Yeah, Renee Richards is right, by the way.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Stop the hammering.
Here it comes, Rob. As you say, Jay, it's your show, but when Rob comes on Mondays, I have to turn it to Sean Slanity. Well, I said Slanity. He's way better to listen to. Time to ditch porn. Wow. I'll never ditch Rob, so go enjoy Slanity.
All right.
Well, you want to talk about ear gas right there? Yeah, listening to Sean Slanity. Good Lord.
I haven't watched cable news in a long time. And for some reason, like, I was in a place that had cable. I don't have cable television at home. I turned on Fox News during prime time, and Sean Hannity was on.
Yeah.
And it was like I couldn't even really understand what he was saying. There were so many buzzwords. It was like, What is he even talking about?
I wonder what he's got in that vape that he got caught smoking when the cameras came back to him.
Got to wonder about that. Yeah.
All right, hang on, Rob. When we come back, more of the Rob Port. It's our weekly North Dakota chat, Jay Dobbins Show. All right, before we move on here, before we move on, well, quick here, let me do a quick email. Our email comes in through Tyler's Tree Service inbox, tylerscut.com, for all your tree needs. Hey, Jay, I agree with you on the college athletes and the pay gap, but we also have to remember they're getting a 100, they're getting a, it says 100, 200,000 to go to school as well. For free. I must be talking about scholarships, too, for free. From, and I get all of it. This person goes on to say some compensation is deserved, though I will. admit, Dad, you're right. Yeah, they're getting a scholarship. But let's be honest, the NCAA and these schools are making a ton. I mean, they're making a ton of money off their jerseys, off their likeness. Yeah, they're getting a scholarship. But I mean, come on. Their parents are still trying to get them through school. They're trying to. Just enough's enough.
A lot of these athletes are very, very smart. There's this stereotype of the dumb jock, which I think is entirely unfair. I mean, a lot of these student athletes are very bright students.
Yep.
But if you look at the schedule that they have to deal with, it's no wonder that a lot of them take, you know, degree or course studies that are not very challenging. Mm-hmm. Because if you look at the amount of time that they have to spend on practice, on traveling to games and everything, it is a grueling schedule that they have to keep up with. Yeah. And the idea that they're doing that while simultaneously being – so, and again, some pull it off, but a lot of these student athletes, which ultimately means that the degrees that they're getting are not exactly top shelf degrees.
Medical,
you know what I mean?
Degrees or anything.
I mean, it's a tough thing. So that we could do a whole show on that.
Yeah, we got to move on. I found out a little piece of information, Rob.
Yeah.
So this tennis player, this Renee Richards, went on to sue and won and all that, and then went on to be a very successful coach. Do you know who outed her?
It was Tucker Carlson's dad.
Richard Carlson. He's a local TV anchor.
He's actually, because he covered the person who did the Dale Carr, he broke that story too.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's very at the end they kind of tie in this whole like slam on Tucker Carlson at the end, which I thought was a little gratuitous, as someone who's not particularly a fan of Tucker Carlson. But overall, very good documentary.
All right, Rob. I believe I heard rumor that you got your second Rona vaccination.
First one.
Oh, you got your first one.
I got my first one.
Did it knock you out?
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Your first one did? Because I'm hearing from people the second one really has nailed them.
Yeah. The UPS guy just rang my doorbell. Chewy.com.
The Chewy packages are here for
what
the puppy.
Can Brown do for you?
I can hear the dog in the background going, it's that box right there. Grab that box off the truck.
Yeah. Anyway, I got my first one on Thursday. I got the Moderna.
Yeah.
And I was a little worried about it because I know people said that, you know, you get the shot and you have some side effects. And I had such a rough go with COVID when I had it that I asked them. And they said, yeah, if you had a rough go of it, your first shot, you know, you might have some side effects. I'll tell you.
What'd you have, man?
Well, Thursday night, you know, I had kind of some body aches and some chills. You know, maybe I had like a low grade fever. Okay. But I didn't think it was anything. No big deal. Right. Went to sleep. Woke up Friday morning, you know, to get up and get the kids ready and get to work.
Yeah.
And, man, I couldn't get out of bed. I was knocked flat. Slept all day, you know, pretty much made arrangements to not work and had Jess take the kids and everything.
Wow.
And I slept all day Friday, all Friday night, Saturday morning. Probably on Saturday, about mid-morning, I finally got out of bed, was feeling a little bit better again. It really knocked me for a loop.
I've heard that second shots from
yeah, I'm not looking forward to my second shot.
Yeah, no. Okay. From some folks I know that got the second shot. The first one, with some real sore arm, others, a little woozy. But the second one, folks I know, the second ones did to them what the first one did to you, Rob. So you got a second one coming, buddy.
Second one coming next month.
Well, and I would be interested to hear what you gentlemen think. So I know somebody who did their research on the three that are available presently with AstraZeneca coming. They're doing more trials. They did their research. They called to make an appointment and asked if that particular vaccine was available, the one that they preferred to get, and were just humiliated.
What do you mean?
Over the phone about wanting to choose a particular vaccine for COVID instead of, you should be taking what we have, what's available, and be happy about it.
Really? Oh, where was this at?
This was a female who I
heard. No, I don't give no
she
names.
Could probably lose her job.
No. I just want to know, where was this at? Was it here?
Yeah, I believe it was here at one of the local clinics.
Oh, here in Cass County.
Yeah, and the nurse, I mean, just vilified her for She basically explained that she has always had a bit of a anxiety and fear and phobia, but she did research and wanted a particular vaccine out of the ones that were available.
And
the nurse just vilified her, chastised her for it. Yeah, nice.
There's no room for that. I mean, just when I posted last week that I got, I just mentioned in passing on social media, hey, I got an appointment to get the Moderna shot. I got like hundreds of comments of people just, why do you want to be a lab rat for big pharma and all this, just like, you know, jumping all over me for getting a vaccine.
I have no concern whatsoever when I get the vaccine. I'm getting it. I have no, you know, like, what was it, 2 weeks ago now? I got the message that, hey, your group's up.
You and I both did. Yeah.
I thought, wow, that's quick. Why would I be up? And I guess it must be because, again, we talk about the medications that I'm on. But I still haven't gotten it because I want to make sure that everybody that needs it has it. Then I'll go in and get it. But I have no fear of this shot at all.
Yeah. In Bismarck, they're giving it away to whoever comes up.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So, I mean, we're right on that, which is why I finally decided to go get it. Because I was like you. I could have got it earlier. Mm-hmm. I fell into one of the earlier categories, and I was just kind of hanging back. And I think because I work for Forum Communications, we're considered essential workers.
Which I find that hilarious.
I understand our reporters and stuff. Held back. I could have got it a lot earlier. I held back for quite a while just because I had some immunity. I had it. I had some immunity, but it just got to a point. It seems like it's so readily available now at this point.
Yeah.
I just thought, you know what? There's hundreds of appointments available in mine, and I'm gonna make an appointment to get a shot. And I'm still glad I did. I mean, even though I had kind of a miserable Friday.
Hey, I'm gonna do a flyover and drop this bomb on you, then take off.
Oh man!
So once you get the
love doing this to me at the end of the segment.
I know. Once you get the second shot, are you ditching the mask?
See
you later.
I haven't thought of it. Yeah, like, you have 3 seconds to respond. You know, I need to put some more thought into that. You know, I don't. I mean, obviously, there's no reason for me to. I guess I don't know. Like, could I? Even though I have some immunity from the vaccine, does that mean I still can't spread it?
Just make sure that you read the side of those mask box. Have you ever read the side of the mask box or package?
Yeah, I've read a few of them.
What's it say, Rob?
All sorts of stuff. Made in China.
I'm not.
In the immortal words of Rand Paul, isn't this just theater?
Yeah. Well, maybe
it says that on the side of the box.
We do a lot of stuff like that for theater.
This product is an ear loop mask. This product is not a respirator, and it will not provide any protection against COVID-19, coronavirus, or other viruses or contaminants.
There you go. Maybe.
There it goes. Oh, that was the second bomb I dropped. What's coming up on the next plane talk, buddy?
I don't know. I'm developing for this live stream thing that we're going to be doing. I'm actually working on that. I got to figure out some camera stuff and all that. But that should be exciting when that gets going.
Yeah, that'll be really cool. All right, as always, fun, buddy. We'll talk again next Monday. And I know that emailer are going to like that, but too damn bad.
Hey, tough.
That's right, brother. Tough noogies.
Hey, you want to live in a free society? Sometimes you're going to have to listen to people you don't like.
I must have missed something on the morning show, too, this morning, because I see there's an email that came in just chewing the wife on something she said this morning about masks, I guess.
Oops.
I must have missed it.
Uh-oh.
I
still don't understand why people get so worked up about masks. It's just a mask. Even if you think it does nothing, what is it? Why do you care if I'm wearing one?
Well, I don't care if you're wearing one. It doesn't bother me.
I'm not you specifically, but there are people who care.
Yeah, I know. I tried to go into Menards on Saturday. I'm like, okay, I'm going to give it a shot. I'm going to give it a shot today. I'm going to try the no mask thing. Because I'm telling you, Rob, here, majority of the places you go to, they say nothing to you. I think they just got the signs hanging up so the people that are worried feel safer. I wasn't even in there in 10 seconds, and they got me.
Really? You know, that's funny, because
I forgot, I'm
we
sorry.
Took the kids,
I had it in my back pocket.
We took the kids to the mall on Saturday.
Yeah.
And here in Minot, and nobody's wearing a mask.
No.
Almost nobody was wearing a mask. Nobody making a big deal about it. Just.
Yeah, well, we had the big St. Patrick's Day parade here Saturday, and a lot of people weren't wearing masks. Although, if you're in the parade, though, and walking in it, you had to have a mask on, and if you're throwing candy, you had to have latex gloves on.
Yeah, okay.
Well, whatever. All right, buddy, we'll talk next Monday.
Thanks, Jay.
All right, thanks, Rob. Appreciate it. WDAY time, 2:33.